Please help me welcome Dr. Nikita Shah.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening, Dr. Nikita. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Very well. Thank you so much for joining us this
evening.
Thank you
for having me.
Yeah, we're so happy to have you. Yes. I was just doing an introduction about, you know, the situation in India and all the people that need help that aren't getting the help. And all the barriers and the fear of the unknown that really holds them back. So I was wondering, Dr. Nikita, if you could help us understand when is the right time for people to approach professional help? I guess often people struggle and just hope that things will just get better,
yes.
Whether they're young moms or, you know, people at different ages or stages in life. What are the signs that indicate that they need to approach a professional to get the help that they need?
Right. I really like that you said that there could be different stages of life. And that is something that's very, very relevant, because any change or any shift in a phase in life automatically becomes a kind of sensitive time when it comes to mental health, because it becomes a stress. So even if it is perceived as something as a happy change, like perhaps getting married or getting a new job or joining a college, all of them are seen as positive changes in life, not just the negative ones, loss or, you know, sometimes even, as you said, young moms, people who've just had babies, just because it's a stage, it contributes to that shift in equilibrium, and that could be a sensitive time. And all of us know that the first few moments of a few weeks of a change in stage require some adapting, and there would be some kind of fear, some kind of sadness, some kind of perhaps understanding of what's going on and adapting to it. But when one finds that these negative emotions, they could be anxiety, they could be sadness, it could be fear, either when it persists or if it is disproportionate to the stressor, right?
Yes.
Or if it has started in a long term affecting your functioning, right? Yes. So like, let's take an example of a young mom. All young moms, maybe like they've just had a baby. All of them have sleep deprivation. So then that becomes the thing is, like, everyone's coping is different from the other person's. So how do we know that I need help, right? So if you're not able to do the functions that you would be wanting to do, right? So if you're feeling tired all the time, which most young moms do, right? But you're not able to go about, you're not able to look after your child, you have intense levels of guilt about it. That is when we know that things are probably not going so well.
Yes.
Similarly, let's say it's something like, you know, someone's just gotten married or someone's just joined a new job. The same thing would apply. That anxiety that initially helps you perform better, makes you be more on the toes, be more attentive, that is becoming a little bit too much. It's affecting your physical parameters. It's affecting your functioning. You're not able to enjoy anything anymore. And if it continues for, like, let's say 7 to 10 days or even 2 weeks,
two weeks
is actually the clinical cutoff for depression.
Yes.
So if it's persistent for 2 weeks, we know that this is trouble. But we have a caveat in our classification system for something called an adjustment disorder. Right.
Okay.
So it's not necessary that just because it's short lived that, you know, you don't get help. You can get help. It just might not be a clinical depression. It could be an adjustment thing. But I think that we have the possibility right now to not just go when it becomes clinical. We can even just go use it as a springboard to help yourself grow, understand yourself better, understand why you're struggling with the adapting at that time. And perhaps that could help you in the long run as well. So it's not necessary that it has to be something so clinical when you seek
Yes.
help.
Yes. That's right. I love what you said about using the professional help as a springboard. You know,
Yes.
so you, no
Yes.
matter what stage you are in, you know, you sometimes an older person would have had so many issues and traumas, and you know, they need to
Yes.
be able to deal with them, deal with it, and then
Yes. Right.
springboard into the next
Yes.
season of their
Right.
life. So
Right.
help can be seen as a springboard. So, you
Yes,
know,
certainly.
yeah.
Yeah. No,
So often
yes.
there's such a negative thing around getting help.
Yes, I agree. Because from what I've been talking to patients, especially as you said, the older patients who've been through a lot in their life, they'd be like, I've been able to deal with everything. I've
Yes.
always been strong. Why
Yes.
is it that right now I have, you know, trouble? You know,
Yes.
I'm
Yeah.
not weak. I've always been strong. So as long as we look at this struggle as an indication of weakness, you know,
Yes.
there will be that hesitation in getting help. And
Yes.
also, if we view what's happening currently as an indicator of who we are, rather than what we're going through, there will be trouble getting help. It could just be about that. That's not who you are. That's just what you're going through at that time.
Yes. That's a key one, isn't it?
Yes.
And I
Yes.
guess sometimes people have pushed through barriers by themselves, and they feel, why do I really need to get help? I've been through a season where I have struggled.
Yes.
I haven't been able to adjust, but I've just through grit and determination, I've just kind of pushed through. What is the benefit of going and seeking professional help to navigate them through these situations?
From what I've seen, a lot of times when we're in a really, really tough spot, as you said, sheer grit and determination and having a sense of purpose can push us through. And a lot of times what I've found is that once that period is over and you have that vacuum where you're not doing anything, that's when the whole situation hits you like a ton of bricks. And that's sometimes when you actually start feeling that anxiety or you start feeling it. So it's almost like, I think like a good example would be that, you know, if a loved one is unwell and you're just running around trying to like sort everything out for them, doing all these hospital visits, going to doctors, doing all of that. And then when all of that settles and like the weight of what you've been through, that stress hits you. Right. So the good thing is when you seek professional help, it isn't just about now. It helps you create a template of what your strengths and weaknesses are and how you can use that, how you can use your strengths and how you can shore up because of your weaknesses and then create like a template of how to deal with these things in the future so that it's not just you being go, 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 go. I'm not going to process it. It allows you to process it. And act at the same time.
Yes, that's a key one. Just helping you to process it and giving you a template so that you have that guidance for the future. That's a really good point. You know, I guess in India especially, there's that whole concept of people see mental health in its extremes, whether it's on the street and you see it before your eyes. So the whole image of mental health is so negative. So just the fact that people would like to approach help, they have these sort of images of what it looks like in front of them, and it freaks people out. They think, no, I don't want to be that person that's an extreme, you know. But so how